Today is August 12, 1996. The survivor is Morris Rich. My name is Bobby Kaufman. We're in Miami, Florida, in the United States. The language of the interview will be English. Today is August 12, 1996. The survivor being interviewed is Morris Rich. My name is Bobby Kaufman. We're in Miami, Florida, in the United States. The interview will be done in English. Good afternoon, Mr. Rich.
How do you do? Nice meeting you.
Thank you. Thanks for agreeing to do this today. Could you state your name as it is now?
My name is Morris Rich. R-I-C-H.
And what was your name at birth?
Moise Uchaisky.
Did you have a middle name or any other name?
No, I didn't. I didn't use my middle name.
Did you have any nicknames?
No, I didn't.
And what did your parents call you?
Meiske.
And your brothers and sisters called you that as well?
Yeah, Meiske.
And in school, what name did you use?
Meiske.
Yeah. What was your language at birth?
Language at birth was actually Yiddish in the house. We were talking.
And in public?
In public, most Yiddish. Only in school, we were talking Lithuanian and Yiddish.
When were you born?
In April 20, 1924.
Where?
Lithuania.
What town?
Kovno.
And where did you grow up?
Slabodka.
Explain that to me.
Slabodka, that's like 10 minutes from Kovno. Only a bridge separated Kovno from Slabodka.
Was Slovakia
Slobodka.
Slobodka?
Slobodka.
Was that a suburb of
Kovno? it was a suburb. Yeah.
And what did it look like? What was it like?
It's a very small little town by itself. And Slobodka was very famous because it was the most biggest yeshivas, or people who want to become rabbis used to come to Slobodka yeshivas. To yeshivas, to learn, you know, to become a rabbi. That's why Slobodka was famous all over the world. When you talk to a rabbi in any country, you say you come from Slobodka, they say, oh, Slobodka, that's the place who became big, people came out from Slobodka, big rabbis.
Did you meet any of them? Did you know any of the
students? Yeah, I met a lot of them. Because a lot of the young people who were studying in the Slobodka yeshivas used to rent rooms in my grandmother's house. And she had all the time like 5 or 6 boarders. And they were all what you call yeshiva bocharim. They were all studying to become rabbis.
How old were they?
Then the students?
Mm-hmm.
17, 18, 20, that age.
So they had already finished their early education?
Yes, they finished their early education and then they went to become rabbis.
Where did you go to school?
I went to Talmud Torah. It's called that school, Talmud Torah.
Was this in the same town?
In the same town, and it was more like a religious school.
Well, what was your day like at school?
We learned, you know, Lithuanian, history, geography, and a lot of Hebrew and religious learnings.
How did you get to school each day? Did you walk?
Walked, yeah.
And what about lunch? Did you go
lunch,
home?
My mother used to give me in a little package, in a bag, in a little paper bag. And I used to eat the lunch, but my mother used to give it to me to take it to school.
Tell me about your family.
family were very devoted parents. My father, my mother, exceptionally devoted. Because God forbid a child got a little fever, you know, like they're calling in this country 99.5 or 100, she used to fall in a panic.
Did she call the doctor?
No, my mother was a doctor by herself. She had already all the remedies, but she learned in all, only in dangerous situations she called the doctor.
What were some of her remedies? What did she do?
Old-fashioned remedies, you know, like certain herbs, you know, certain things, you know. Like now we are, like we are starting now in the United States with vitamins. My mother knew already many years ago certain things, you know, what makes you feel better.
What was your mother's name?
Odell.
And her maiden name?
Flink. Odell Flink.
When was she born?
My mother was born in 1900.
Where?
Lithuania.
What was your father's name?
Chaim. His first name, Ruchaisky.
Would you spell Ruchaisky for me?
Oh, that I'm going to give you a good job now. It's Rutschaisky.
And where was he born?
He was born Lithuania, in Lithuania.
Do you know how your parents met?
I think my mother told me that she visited her girlfriend, and her girlfriend was married already at that time to a tailor, and my father knew the tailor, they were friends with the tailor, and that's how they met.
I see.
Yeah.
And you have brothers and sisters?
My brothers and sisters, they were the same thing, going to school with me together.
What were their names?
My brother's name is, my older sister's name is Fege. My brother's name is Abraham. And my younger sister's name is Miriam. And my little brother who got killed in the crematorium with my mother, his name was Solomon.
Tell me what your house looked like.
It was houses like almost like what they built in the Carolinas, from logs, wooden logs, but chopped wooden logs. And it was a very special build like that to keep warm. And inside was wallpaper and beautiful, and it was very comfortable.
Describe it a little more.
Yes. We didn't have central air conditioning or central heat. We had stoves. And we had, in the winter time, to take chop wood and keep on eating up the ovens to keep the whole house warm. But it was a very comfortable, warm house. And outside the house, we had a lot of big fields, and people grew in the summertime tomatoes, cucumbers, and all the time when we looked it out, we saw green. Because we lived actually in the outskirts of Slabodka. We didn't live right in the heart of Slabodka. We lived already outside, because they started to build factories and houses around there, and we moved there.
So did you have a yard?
Yeah, we had a yard, and we had a place, a little to play, a little football too, soccer.
You like soccer?
Yeah, that was my main game was soccer.
Well, did you play on a team, or how did you play?
Yeah, I played. We had a whole team from Talmud Torah. And I was, not to praise myself, I was very fast. And I played all the time the outside right.
Did people come watch your games? Did your parents?
Yeah, sometimes, yeah, they did. But I played too much already. My mother used to get angry because sometimes I didn't come on time for dinner. And she used to say, yeah, he's playing already soccer again, that football. That's right.
What else did you do as a kid?
Ping pong we played. A lot of ping pong. And in the winter time, we lived not far, what is called the Linkwear Mountain, big hills. And we had sleds, and we used to sled down from the mountains, which is involved in a little danger, but we did it. That was in our winter sport, to go to that Linkwear Mountain and use the beefy sleds to go down.
What did your father do?
He was a wood turner.
What exactly does that mean?
To make you laugh, he takes a square piece of wood and he makes it round. But that's not all. I'm just making a joke. A wood turner is who makes parts for furniture, architectural, and industrial. Anything that's got to do with shaping out of wood, and people have to make a casting to make metal, or build a home with fancy columns, or use spools for the textile industry. My father had to supply all these type turnings. Some of the big textile companies needed a very precise spools. So when the machines run, the spool was not little spools like we buy in the store. It was commercial spools, almost, you know, a foot tall and about 6 inches in diameter, built almost, you know, like a tapered bottle. And these spools had to go very precise. Otherwise, the silk or the cotton tears. Mm-hmm. So it's got to run very good. And my father was actually very precise, excellent wood turner.
Did you learn with him?
I used to keep an eye. He didn't want to learn to teach me.
Why?
Because wood turning was a poor trade. Even you are a specialist and precise, but all trades in my country, turnings, wood turning, tailors, shoemakers, all trades, we are hardly making a good living. It was a...
So what did he hope for you?
He worked hard, and he was very good in his trade, so he made a better living than other wood turners. Mm-hmm. Because he was more actually like an educated wood turner. He knew how to read blueprints, and he was a self-educated person. He used to read a lot of books, and he knew how to complete a job according to the blueprint. And that's why he had more jobs than other wood turners who did only, you know, like furniture turnings. My father did a lot of turnings for industrial too. Before you make a mold for iron or parts for machinery, it had to be made first in wood turned, and then it had to be casted. And that had to be turned according to the blueprint. And my father was very good.
You must have learned something from him.
Of course I learned. I used to sneak in the shop, and he used to go to a customer to deliver and play around with his tools. But he recognized when he came back, some of the tools was a little cheap. He says, somebody was already in the shop. Who was in the shop?
Did they know it was you? Were you the little bad boy?
Yeah, I was a bad boy. It's true. They didn't want me to go in the shop for one reason. He says, when you start going to the shop, you'll become a wood turner. And there is better things than wood turning. And that's why I didn't like me to go into the shop.
You said there was books in your house?
Yeah, we had all different types. My father was a well-read person. He knew everything, what was going on in this world.
Did you know what was happening at the beginning of the war?
Yes. My father knew that the war is going to come because he didn't only read Jewish newspapers or Lithuanian newspapers. He even read my account. And according to this, he told all the time my mother, we don't have a chance to hang around Lithuania. And he knew exactly what it's going to be. But my mother didn't want to believe, you know. Nobody wants to believe in bad things, what's going to come out. But he knew, you know, Hitler's plan. And when he started to take all the other countries, you know, Czechoslovakia, and it started with the war in Poland, you know. But before the war in Poland, he begged my mother. He says, let's sell the house, let's sell the shop, let's get out, let's go to my family in the United States.
Who was in the United States?
In the United States was my old father's family most, the brothers. He had two. He had three sisters in the United States, and they left many years before the war. Lucky, they left in the right time. But my mother all the time contradicted him. She said, oh, Chaim, you're a wood turner. Look at the big manufacturers, the big names, Ulam Perl, Serasevsky, the big textile, actually Jewish tycoons, what you call in Slavotke. But they had nice factories. They are building the factories larger, and they don't leave Lithuania. So you are the philosopher? You are the only smart man? You want to run? He says, it's going to be bad. There it says, all standing on an iceberg which is melting under our feet. And it's going to melt, and we're all going to be sunk and drowned and dead and murdered.
Do you actually remember these conversations?
Yeah, I remember all the time. Because we were kids and we used to say, yeah, yeah, Papa, let's go to America. Let's go, let's go, let's go. But, you know, how what happens, you know. My father was a good husband, and he didn't want to push too hard. Mm-hmm. But when the war broke out, my mother cried with bitter tears. And she said, bitterly, crying, look, she says, your father, how right he was, look. Look at exactly what he said, exactly the outcome, what it is. Because Hitler had systematically, you know, done what he was writing in his Mein Kampf, you know. All, you know, organized, you know, planned how to kill out all the Jews.
Well, let's go back. I want to ask you a few more things, and we'll get to this.
Yes.
How did you practice your Judaism in your home?
First of all, I was going to the Talmud Torah, so I learned all the time. 40% of the education in Talmud Torah was Hebrew and the Bible and Tanakh and Chumash, you know, all the Jewish laws and a little Gemara. So I knew already, you know, about the Jewish, you know, traditions and the Judaism, you know. And my mother was keeping a kosher house. All the people in Slabodka, they are kosher.
Were there non-Jews in your town?
Yeah, a lot of non-Jews, yeah.
Were you friends with them? Did you interact?
Yeah, we were some of them. We were very friendly. And it turned out when the war starts, we didn't know we were not friendly. Because we had very big disappointments. Because some of our friendly people who were our neighbors came in right away to look for my father to kill him.
What
when
happened?
The war broke out.
What happened?
They were Lithuanians, you know, Gentile people. And they were preparing for years. If something comes up, and they saw the war with Poland, and then the Russians in 1940 took Lithuania, all the Baltic countries, you know, after that pact with Russia. You see, Germany and Russia made a pact, and the Russians got certain countries like a gift for cutting in, you know, with Hitler that peace, so-called pact. It was, you know, later nothing. So the Lithuanians already prepared themselves with rifles and with weapons, digging in right in their yards. And I myself came in one time to my father and I says, what is Mazuras, one of our neighbors? Mr. Mazuras, what is he digging all the time and walking in his yard? And my father says, I don't know. I hope he doesn't bury weapons there, because we had a feeling that he had, you know, he was like an organizer. A lot of Lithuanian gentle people used to come to his home. And the fact is, any time, you know, the telephone was ringing in our house, customers, because we had a telephone, and he didn't have a telephone. So when people used to call for him, I used to come into his house and say, Mr. Mazuras, you're called to the telephone. And we were nice to him all these years, but not after the war broke out. After the war broke out, that same man, Mazuras, gave out all a lot of gentle Lithuanians the weapons, and they were the first ones, after 6 days when the Germans marched in Lithuania, did the pogrom in Slabodka. He didn't kill my mother or our children, but he came to kill my father. And my father was already killed. Because he was in the first day, he was going to see if a train is going. And the Lithuanians, already partisans, they called themselves, grabbed him right by the train, and they took him away to the 9th Fort with a lot of other Jewish men, and they killed him later.
After the time that the Soviet Union took over Lithuania, that was in 1940?
Yeah, May. They marched in May.
How did life change right away then?
It was a big change, of course. It's for the rich people who had the textile factories and all the big enterprises, you know, was not too happy because it was right away taken away by the Russians, and it was made, you know, cooperative factories, you know. But for the poor people who didn't have anything to lose, you know, the Russians, they were against religion, of course. So the religious schools were already starting to change, you know. And it was a change in general, you know, when the Russians came in. It was not a happy outcome.
And the pogroms started then?
No, but the Russians was not pogroms. The Russians just took away from rich people properties, and they wanted to everybody to become a communist. But not everybody wanted to be a communist. So it's already, you know, a a problem causing, you know. But it was no killings by Russian soldiers or Russians to kill Jews.
That began when the Germans invaded?
When the Germans marched in.
And your neighbor took part in this pogrom?
Yeah.
What happened? He came into your house? Was he with?
He came in into the house, yes. And he says, "Where is Chaim?" My mother says, "Chaim is not here. We don't know where he is." We didn't know yet that my father was killed. He says, "You all can be in your house. Nothing's going to happen to you. But I must find Chaim." And he had a hate against my father. He didn't find Chaim, so he just walked out from the house. And he says, "I'm going to tell my partisans not to touch your house." But he went and he killed plenty of Jews in other sections.
And I imagine you knew these Jewish families.
Oh, yeah, we knew a lot of families. Yeah.
And did you all communicate with each other? What
happened? It was hard to communicate after the war broke out already. Because walking from one place to the other, your life was in danger. Because the Lithuanians, when the war broke out, they were the first killers. Before even the Germans marched in, the Lithuanians already were shooting and killing Jews.
Who armed the Lithuanians?
The Lithuanians.
How did they get their arms, their ammunition?
They were preparing already for years in the underground.
Yeah. Right, we're going to stop for a minute now.
Yeah.
You say the Lithuanians had been preparing for this time. Why do you say that? How do you know that?
Because Lithuania, I hate to say that, is one of the most anti-Semitic countries, little countries in the world, Lithuania. What's the reason? We don't know. But Lithuanians had all these years hate against the Jews.
Did you experience any of that before the war?
All the time.
What happened?
When we used to go from school home, we used to be stoned by gentle kids. We had to run. When it used to be a soccer game between Maccabi and the Lithuanian commanders, you know, teams in soccer. And if the Jews were about to win, we had to run from the stadium very fast. Otherwise, we were beaten and stoned again. If a Jewish boxer knocked out a gentle Lithuanian in the ring, the people outside the boxing arena was in danger already, with clubs and stones, and the fights used to break out terrible. And Lithuanians, even though a Catholic country, you know, the Lithuania, and for they're old thinking that the Jews are at fault of Jesus' death. And this is the old fanatic Lithuanians who couldn't get away from that we killed Jesus.
Did any authorities ever come to the aid of the Jews?
When it was real bad, they came. But if they saw far away a gentle Lithuanian beating up a Jewish Lithuanian, they looked a little on the side. Another couple of punches wouldn't hurt.
And how did you handle that personally? What were you thinking?
I was thinking all the time, that's how we live. It's our country. I was born here. It's Lithuania. Maybe one of these days they are going to get more educated, more sensible, more modern, and understand more all about what life is, that they're all human beings and we are under the same God, you know, and we have the same right to live. But it didn't come so fast that even old gentle people with crosses wearing, they still hated Jews. That's right. And to say the truth, you know, it was very hard to make friends with the Lithuanians. Even they are friendly with you on the outside, but in their hearts, they were not friends. And that's why when they made the pogroms, and the Germans were already, you know, it was a free city, Kovno and Slabodka. The Russians were already escaping, you know, chasing away, because the Germans came in with such a power. They bombed the airfields, and the Russians, the soldiers, they were not organized no more. They didn't see the officers anymore. It was a chaos in the Soviet army, because of the speed of Hitler's war was so organized that they were off balanced. And the Lithuanians right away took that for a good opportunity to start killing. So before even the Germans marched in, and it was almost like a free city, you know, only a couple of Russian soldiers who got lost, didn't know where to run. They were confused, but no officers. The Lithuanians already, they killed them. The Soviet army soldiers, the Russians. So you see how the hatred was against. And when the Germans were already in Lithuania, they didn't tell the Lithuanians, go kill the Jews. They did it by themselves, happy. And they did the first pogroms, and they killed 1,000 Jews in Slabodka. With knives and eggs, they knocked off people's Jewish heads.
Did you see this happening?
My brother went to a bakery. My mother said, go in, he says, Abraham, to the bakery by Sandler. Maybe you can get some bread left over there. My brother walked in the bakery. It was all dark. And when he walked in, on the ground, on the floor, was laying Mr. Sandler and Mrs. Sandler and their sons. They're all laying in a puddle of blood, and all the throats were sliced. And he came back home and he says, Mommy, the Sandlers are all dead. They're laying all in blood. And my mother says, don't talk like that. How do you know? Maybe you didn't see good. He says, Mother, I saw it. And my mother said, It's bitter, Kinder. Children, it's bitter. We got to start hiding ourselves. And that was a big, you know, pogrom made by the Lithuanians. Not even one German took act in the pogrom. The Germans took later their business, systematically, according to the books and according to the orders of the system how to kill out the Jews, you know, to exterminate the Jews. All with the system, all things. But the Lithuanians, like butchers, they slaughtered. And it was two groups of Lithuanians who did the job. One group was educated, college Lithuanians who killed Jews, slaughtered them in the houses, and they walked away from the houses. The other group, Lithuanians, they killed the Jews and they robbed them. They came with little wagons, with horses, and they started taking out furniture, the jewelry, and all valuables in the house. So there were two groups in the pogrom. The educated killed and walked away with guns, with pistols. The other group was Lithuanians robbed and slaughtered like in butchers and killed the Jews.
Was this the local population? Did you know any of these people?
Yes, we knew plenty. Because my grandmother's house, my grandmother had a cellar, and all the family went into the cellar to hide.
Your family?
Yeah, not my family. We were not living near my grandmother. My grandmother lived on Jürbiger Street, which is a real Jewish section. The same thing like in New York, Delancey Street, the same was Jürbiger Gas, like the Delancey Street. And they were all hiding in that cellar, and the cover of the cellar was covered with a carpet, like in my house here. And a table was, after they went in, they let down the thing with the table and chairs around. And when the pogrom started, and the Lithuanians started to kill house to house, and Jürbiger Gas, the people, the woman, gentle woman, used to help my grandmother sometimes. And my grandmother treated her very well. She used to eat by the same table with my grandmother and grandfather and with my old uncles for years and years. She came in with a lot of the Lithuanian hooligans, partisans, and she heard the voice of Janova, that was her name, the woman who was taking care of my grandmother's house many years and helping her. And she said, looks like nobody's here. Maybe they're in the synagogue, in the new synagogue. The name is the Naye Shul. The gentle woman said to the other partisans, the Lithuanians, let's go there. They must all hiding themselves in the new synagogue. And they all went to the new synagogue, and there was a lot of Jews hiding really there, and they slaughtered all the Jews in that synagogue. And that was by a woman who knew all the people in Slabodka, especially Jürbiger Gas.
Did your grandmother tell you that?
Yeah, my grandmother told me that.
Why do you think your family was saved?
I would say it was pure luck. If we would have lived at Jürbiger Gas, we would have been slaughtered the same thing like the 1,000 other Jews were slaughtered. But we lived at the outskirts between a lot of, you know, fictress was all around there. Maybe we were saved. But it was a time my mother got scared already, too. And she started, you know, to separate some of us, the children. And in the beginning, we thought that it's going to be more safer to live in the Jewish section than in the Gentile where we lived, you know, on the outskirts. So for a couple of days, my mother sent me away to my grandmother to live. And that was actually a day before the pogrom, a day or 2 days before the pogroms. But the Germans were already in Lithuania.
Do you remember the Germans arriving in Lithuania?
Yes, when I was in my grandmother's house, sleep over the night, and that was June the 26th. I got up. Yeah, it was the 25th, I'm sorry. 25th in the morning. I heard, you know, noise, and I went in my grandmother's yard, and a ball, like a soccer ball, over the fence fell in right in my grandmother's yard. So I looked at the ball, and I opened up the gate, and I saw all the trucks, the German trucks, the army trucks, and all ammunition, and the part of the German army was already on Hürbürger Gas. And the Germans were sitting on the trucks with the shiny boots, with the fancy uniforms, drinking champagne, and the Lithuanian gentle girls greeting them with flowers, collaborators, right away with the German army, and kissing and hugging. And the trucks were clean, and the uniforms. And I couldn't believe. I said, how could the army march in the wartime without a shot, you know? How did they came in so fast? In a war, I thought it's the most powerful army in the world. My heart was crying. I couldn't believe. I thought they're going to take over the world. They were giggling and smiling and clean and drinking champagne and eating chocolate and were kissed by the girls, the Lithuanians. And then, while I was still looking, you know, through the gate, they grabbed a lost Soviet soldier who didn't know. Remember, I told you it was a chaos and a lot of soldiers got lost. They didn't know where to run. And one soldier was hiding himself behind the corner house there with a machine gun. And German aeroplanes were starting already to come, you know, fly around over the Slobodka, you know, in the skies. And that Russian soldier with a machine gun tried to shoot down the aeroplane. And the soldier was like a Mongolian, you know, from Russia, you know, from that descent, from this Russian, you know, all different types of soldiers from different places of the country. But I saw on his face, when they grabbed him and dragged him right across the street of my grandmother's house, a big officer, a German, I don't know his rank, but he was one of the biggest. When the soldiers, the German, grabbed him, they brought him right to that big officer, and the officer called him like that, closer to him with his finger. And the Russian soldier walked closer and closer, and the German took out a sword and it chopped off his head in front of me while I was looking through the gate. When I saw that, I ran into my grandmother and I was crying, I couldn't stop. And I says, Grandma, I just saw the German chopping off the Russian soldier's head. Look at right there. Look at there, near Glick's house. The man lived near Glick. Right near Glick's house. He says, don't talk silly things like that. Maybe you didn't see anything. I says, I saw, Grandma. And then I decided I'm going to try to go back home. When I saw the army coming in, that German army, I thought there was no future no more. I thought the whole world is going to be taken by Hitler. Because I've never seen such a power with such a weapons, with such an organization, that they smashed, you know, in Lithuania, they smashed the Russian army so fast. They grabbed thousands and thousands, tens of thousands prisoners. They didn't have a chance to escape even, the Russian army from Lithuania. They were grabbed, you know, all over, you know, as prisoners. And that was a very big disappointment for me. I thought there's no chance. But I saw the chance, and we'll talk later. I saw the shining German army, and then 3 years later, I've seen the German army laying in the gutter, and they couldn't walk without shoes. But by the same Soviet army was chasing them, and they didn't know how to run, and they were laying in the street. I saw both sides, but it took 3.5 years of punishment, killed out plenty of Jews, till we saw what a change it was.
You went back home to your mother?
Yeah, went back home from my grandmother's house, and I went back to our house, and I said to my mother what I just saw. It's exactly like our papa said, our father said. Exactly what he was saying, it's happening. And my mother couldn't stop crying.
How did you learn about your father's fate?
About my father's fate, I learned almost 9 months later. A man was released from the ninth fortress, where all the Jews from Slobodka, Kovno, were all taken to the seventh fort. Sorry, not the ninth, seventh fortress. They were all taken from the streets and from the homes, from Kovno, Slobodka, taken all to the seventh fort to be killed. So one of my father's friends, he was a cabinet maker, and his name was Melamed. He was on that fort. And he had a friend, a Lithuanian. He took part of killing, you know, with the other Lithuanians, the Jews. Was a friend with that Jew, Melamed. He built for him furniture a lot of times. And he said to him, before shooting, you know, groups of people, the way they would do the killings, groups, you know, like 50 at a time or 30, he was almost at the grave to be shot, that the Lithuanian partisan, we call them partisan, the Lithuanians, because they acted like partisans, you know, against the Russians, and against the Russians, of course. He recognized him, he says, Melamed. And he stopped, you know, gave the order not to shoot that group of people. And he called out Melamed, the cabinet maker, and he gave an order to release him, take him away from the seventh fort. And when Melamed came in the ghetto, when we had already the ghetto, and I was talking to him, and he knew my father well, in conversation, he threw in words, and he skipped out. Mm-hmm. And he said, your father and your cousin, Meshal Leipke, they were shot in the seventh fort.
So he didn't really want to tell you.
He didn't want to tell me, but in conversation, he told me. But till I found it out, I thought any day my father is coming back. We didn't know he was shot. So near my house was a two-story house. Friends lived, a Jewish family, Arnovsky. So I used to go up on the second floor all the time, every day, before we went into the ghetto. And I used to look through that little window, because from our house was a big field. And when we used to walk home, we used to cut through that field. So I used to look at every day through that window if my father is coming. And when I saw from far away a man, you know, with a short build, stocky, from far away, oh, my father is it. And when it came closer, it was not my father, it's somebody, a gentle man or a farmer. And for weeks and weeks, I used to climb up in Arnovsky's second floor and look through the window and wanted to see if my father is coming back. Because it was rumors that a lot of the Jews were caught as we were digging, you know, sod, you know, like we put in on the lawn here in Miami. As we were digging sod in a small little town out of Kovno called Zesmer. It was just a rumor. And there's a lot of Jews working there. They grabbed a lot of Jews from the railroad station and they took him to Zesmer. So I thought my father was in Zesmer too, and he's going to come any day home. And till we went in into the ghetto, I used to climb up on the second floor and look and see if my father is coming back. Can never forget that.
Was the Jewish community in any way unified at this time? Was there any leadership?
No, not till we went into the ghetto. Because a lot of the rabbis and big leaders were already taken to the forts too, to the fortress, you know, to be killed.
Do you think they purposely tried to get the leadership of the community first? Or
they took the real leadership and educated Jews were taken in. They were taken away when the ghetto was closed. Mm-hmm. Then they could really surround them.
I
understand?
When
the ghetto was closed, August the 17th, 1941, the ghetto was closed August the 17th, 1941. Ghetto was closed with all the wires and everything. Mm-hmm. Then the Germans gave an order. There was already a Jewish committee in the ghetto.
Let's backtrack 1 minute. The Germans came in June 1941. And the ghetto was established by August.
August the 15th.
How did you know about the ghetto? What?
It was already, they started to grab Jews to dig holes and start building defenses around a certain neighborhood where the ghetto was established to being made. The Germans already and the Lithuanians all together started to lay out and made a plan which sections are going to be in the ghetto.
And where was the ghetto?
The ghetto was in Slobodka, not in Kovne, and it started two or three streets in of Jürbacher Strasse, Jürbacher Gas. And it took a lot of homes, you know, surrounded. I cannot mention how many streets and how many sections. But in the beginning of the ghetto, I think it was about 25 or 30,000 Jews in the ghetto.
Was the ghetto, was it established in what was a Jewish section of town?
It was most of the Jewish sections and a small part of the taken away from the Gentile sections. But a very small part. But then the Gentile sections was given back because I made selections and they killed many Jews. So the ghetto became smaller. So the ghetto, the Gentile people started to get back, you know, their homes.
Okay, we're going to stop now for a minute.
Okay.
How did you know about the establishment of the ghetto? How was the population made aware of it?
It was giving out orders. Everybody, every Jew, from old to young, must enter the ghetto. If they don't enter the ghetto by August 15, everybody is going to be shot.
How are these orders given?
It was microphones, loudspeakers, and a lot of paper was glued down all over on the telephone poles and houses. It was all printed, you know, forms, you know, on every house glued down.
Like every door, every person's door?
Every person's door. And all the time, constantly on the radios, and they drove around with trucks and big, you know, loudspeakers in every street. All Jews must come by the 15 and report themselves and enter the ghetto. And it was a lot of shootings. A lot of people were shot right away in different streets. And the fear became big. And there was no way out. You couldn't hide yourself and you couldn't stay in your house. If you stayed in your house, a Gentile neighbor would come in right away and say, "Why don't you go to the ghetto? I'm calling the Germans, Lithuanians." The Lithuanian, if he wanted to hide himself in Kovne or on a side street, not to go in the ghetto, a Lithuanian neighbor would say right away, "Are you still here? It's already the 14th, tomorrow you gotta go." Because he was waiting already, the Jew to leave all the furniture. Not everybody could take everything with them. It was no transportation to move or to take things. So you took your valuables, clothes, soft things, but furniture, you hardly could drag it. Jewish people didn't have, you know, trucks or things like that. You know, you had to hire people with horses. So everybody left their homes and they all entered by the 15th the ghetto.
How much notification did you have?
We had notification almost, the Germans came in on the 25th. I think it took like 3-4 weeks. It was like free, you know. Mm-hmm. And then they start building the fences already. They had the plan made where the ghetto would be. and they start grabbing Jews. And to start digging the holes where the poles are going to be.
How did your family prepare to leave?
My mother didn't want to prepare. She didn't want to believe that we got to leave our house. But she worked so hard, and we were poor people till they built our house, that she's going to leave the house. She even started to cry, "Let them kill me, I'm not going to go." And we begged her and we kissed her. And the last ones, they entered the ghetto, there was, I think, our family. Because our house, the real house where we lived, was not far from the ghetto where we were told where we are going to live. Because when I was in the ghetto, I could look through the fence and see my house through the fence and see gentle people already living in my house, a family, and the children were playing croquet. Mm-hmm. But my father used to turn, you know, for the toy stores before the war. And he used to sell the croquets. So when we left the ghetto, we didn't take the croquets with us. We knew we are not going to play croquet, we are not going to sell croquets. So we left a big stack of croquets. Croquet. And when I used to walk out from my house, where I lived in the ghetto, and look through the wires, while the guards were watching us, you know, I didn't escape. He knew I was not going to escape, but I was just looking through the fence. I saw the gentle children playing croquet, and I really cried.
Mm. How old were you?
I really cried. I was 17 years old. I cried with bitter tears. Mm. And I said to my brother, I didn't want to tell my mother, "Avremke, look. Look through the fence. Chasing the balls, knocking with the hammer, the croquets, the children." That's right. That was the situation.
What did your family take with you?
We took only soft pillows, blankets, clothes, candle holders, candlesticks, the silver ones, religious things, and whatever food we had. That's all the
two. What kind of food did you have then?
We had like potatoes, green peas, little food that we had, that every household had. And we didn't have too much, because when we went in the ghetto, we were already 2-3 June, July. We were already rationed and we couldn't get no food. Mm. So we had very little food, only from some gentle people which we traded. My mother said, "Moiske, go give that farmer my gold earrings and bring me a bag of green peas." And my mother said, "Green peas, we don't have beef." My mother was like, I told you before, my mother was like a half a doctor with all her remedies. She says, "Green peas is almost the same thing like you eat beef. So I don't want to know fancy things for my earrings, like a chicken or a piece of other food. But potatoes and green peas," he says, "if you can get me as much as you can." So we used to trade, and some of the farmers, you know, before we went into the ghetto, was very anxious to get the Jews gold, rings, silver. And the farmers from far away, from miles and miles away, from little towns, from little villages, had, you know, the rumors that the Jews are buying bread and green peas and food, and look what I just got. I got earrings, I got rings, I got silver, I got this. So a lot of farmers start to sneak it little before the ghetto. But when the ghetto was closed, you couldn't bring anything. Because the guards would shoot.
Did your mother bring in anything valuable into the ghetto?
Yes, she brought in the jewelry what she had. And, you know, she had materials, textile, you know, because my father used to work for textile factories. So sometimes they used to give him a bonus, and my mother bought, you know, she liked to sew a lot. She used to make her own clothes for us. She was a very good of sewing up things, you know. She was a very talented woman, my mother. So she had all the time materials, textile materials. And this, when the war broke out, they took all the textile materials into the ghetto. And that's helped a lot, you know, in the ghetto, when I'm going to tell you, when they used to take us out of the ghetto with guards to work on the airport when the Germans were building. So quietly, we used to trade with gentle people, give them a piece of material for a suit, and we used to get a bag, 15 or 20 pounds or 10 kilo of potatoes.
You said in the house where you were told you were going to live?
Yes.
What did you mean?
That was already a Jewish committee. Already established before the ghetto was closed in. It was organized already a Jewish committee with very educated people like Dr. Elkes, very prominent people from the Zionist organizations, a lot of doctors like big Zionist Rabinowitz from the iron wholesale stores. He was a very prominent man in the ghetto, Rabinowitz, and he knew my father very well. And we were saved a lot of times by that Mr. Rabinowitz, because my father used to do for them certain turnings. So actually in the ghetto, when it was a lot of selections to be taken out from Lithuania to Estonia, to other places, and we had to make the lists, the Jewish committee had to deliver to the Germans 1,000 Jews, 500 Jews, and the committee didn't have no choice. So they made lists with names, and they knew already in each house the names of the families. It was already organized in the committee. So that Mr. Rabinowitz, rest his soul, he saved us from a lot of terrible selections.
Would this have been like the Judenrat?
Exactly. It's in German, it's called the Judenrat.
Can you name any of the other people who were on this committee?
Was Dr. Elkes, Kalenzon, Mr. Brick, Rabinowitz, Gershowitz, Dr. Greenberg, Dr. Berman, and Mrs. Dr. Kaplan, a woman doctor, Mrs. Kaplan, and a lot more people. They were in the committee, and they were the leaders, but when they had an order from the Gestapo to deliver so many people, nothing they could do. And truthfully, the committee, the Judenrat, like you say, for a long time didn't know 100% if Jews were taken out from the ghetto, that they were killed. Till on the May one of the major selections, then they took out the 1,800 people and the clothes from these people. There were trucks driven by through Yuba gas. Then the people were shot. Their clothes were taken in from the fortress. Then the Jewish committee knew that any time they take out people, there is going to be killed. But a lot of times they took out people not to be killed. They took people in different sections, in different parts of Lithuania for slave labor. Like they took people to Kedan. They took people to other little villages and states in Lithuania to do labor work. But when they took out these people, it was a different atmosphere than when they took out people to kill. When they took people to kill, the SS, the way they acted was in a different manner. A lot of them were drunk. A lot of them knew that these 1,500 people are going to be dead in 5 or 6 hours, like cattle, you know, in a slaughterhouse. So they treated these people, you know, with the rifle butts over the heads, over the shoulders. March fest, lauf, schnell. It was a different type of treatment than people go to when they took people out for labor. Because they figured no use crippling the people when they take them to labor, they're not going to be able to work. But when the commanders, the Gestapo came, and they knew already that these type of people are going to, these people are going to be killed, these people were treated like cattle to a slaughterhouse. So the committee, the Jewish committee, knew most of the time already, but they didn't have no choice. Dr. Elkes couldn't say, kill me, I'm not going to give out no more Jews. So they would find another leader, a Jewish man who wants to save his life. It couldn't help. It's nothing against the Jewish committee. Nobody of the Jews have any anger against the Jewish committee, especially in Lithuania, because they couldn't help themselves. It was almost like a lotto. They took these, and I'm sure they wiped their tears from their faces when they had to make list to give out 800 people, or 2,000 people, or 500 people, because it was not plain people who did this type of war, this type of committee work. It was all distinguished, educated, good-hearted people. I'm not talking about the Jewish police, you know, in the ghetto. Mm-hmm. They were already a different type of people, you know. Some of them were real, poor elements.
Well, what was that like? What were the Jewish police in the ghetto?
That after the ghetto was established, they needed to know somebody, Jewish people, you know, to keep control. One Jew shouldn't drop from the other Jew. So, and the Jewish police had to do work for the committee. If the Germans wanted that and that street Jews to come to that place to go to work to the airfield, the Jewish police used to knock on the doors. Rabinowitz, get up. It's 6 in the morning. Your family is today, your time to go to the airfield to work, to the airport. The Germans were building an airport and thousands of people had to work, taken to that slave labor work. So who had to organize and take all the Jews near that gate, that the Jews used to march out to go to work, the Jewish police, that was their job.
Who appointed them? Did the Jews select their own police? Or
no,
the
committee.
The committee?
The Jewish committee gave out orders with little, you know, plaques, you know, and again, you know, on houses, who wants to be a Jewish policeman? So there were a lot of, you know, young, strong people, you know, with cool, good Navy nerves, and they were not my age. They were all older, you know, like, but I don't think if I would be their age, maybe I would have nerve to be a policeman. I mean, they didn't have no weapons, the Jewish police. They just had like little police club, a piece of wood, or a piece of leather strap. But they were powerful enough. A Jewish policeman could, if he didn't go to work, they could have gone to the committee and tell Dr. Elkes or the other people that family refuses to go to work. One day, another day, and then the committee says, listen, if you got to take a little stronger force, a couple of slaps or a kick, you got to do it.
What was your work in the ghetto?
I used to work in the beginning to go, we were taken to the airport too, till they established and they developed what's called Werkstatten, the ghetto Werkstatten, that means working shops for the Third Reich, for the German army. So they developed big factories in the ghetto, was established. And all, it was an order after it was all organized to make all these shops in the ghetto, cabinet work, furniture makers, tailors, shoemakers, toy makers, laundry factories, to wash for the Germans the laundry for the Gestapo. All was established in the ghetto. And it was given orders by the Jewish committee, anybody who is a tailor, anybody who is a shoemaker, anybody who is a wood turner, anybody who is a cabinet maker should register to the committee. And you are going to get an Ausweis, that means a card, a working card, that you are working in the ghetto shops, you understand? Mm-hmm. So you don't have to go no more to the airfields, airport, to do the hard, rough labor work, you understand? So I registered. I didn't know too much wood turning, but I knew a little already. For my father, you know, all the time sneaking in the shop, so I had already a little idea, you know, and I knew a little. And before we were taken to the ghetto, my father was not in the shop. I used to go in all the month and a half till we went in the ghetto, and I practiced a lot in the shop to forget my problems, to forget my troubles. I used to run to the lathe and do a little, you know, practicing my father's trade, turning. And you know what they say, wood turning is a trade. If your father is a wood turner, it's in your blood. It's like you would be born under the lathe. Mm-hmm. So I registered to be a wood turner, and I said to my brother, he was a kid too, 2 years younger than me, I says, Avremke, let's go register too. We'll not have to go anymore to work on the airport. So we registered and in the committee was Rabinowitz, my father's friend, and he gave us the Ausweis with the number, with everything. So the police couldn't catch us, you know, in the ghetto in the street and drag us to the airport or to other certain, you know, the Germans took people to work. It was not only the airport, there were a lot of places the Germans took people from the ghetto to work. Yes. And I started work in the Werkstatt, in the ghetto shop. And when I worked in the ghetto shop, it was already a better atmosphere for me. I felt a little more safer. And all the tailors, my uncles were tailors, they worked in the shops. And a lot of my friends worked in the shops. And a matter of fact, that big man, that leader, Rabinovich, had a son approximately my age. Mr. Rabinovich said to me, "Meisale, teach my boy a little wood turning too." So it was a row of lathes. I used to teach him all the time how to hold a tool, how to cut, and we were starting to work in the Werkstatt. I was turning parts for toys, wooden toys, aeroplanes, tanks, trucks, bombs, wooden bombs. And there was a department of artists in the same Werkstatt who did a painting and put on the swastika, you know, and the tanks and the wooden toys. And they, after the tank was all finished, it looked like a miniature real German tank, because we had designers in the Werkstatt, Jewish designers and architects who drew, you know, exactly how the tanks, the toy tanks or the toy trucks had to be made. And when it was finished, it was excellent toys. And the Germans were happy. And we used to pack it in cartons, and it was shipped to Germany for the German children and for the German army's kids to play with toys made by the Jews in the ghetto. Understand? While our children were killed and slaughtered, we had to make for the German children toys for them to play in Germany. And that was heartbreaking.
What kind of hours did you work?
In the ghetto, I think about 10 hours, something like that.
And what food did you have?
In the ghetto, we used to get portions of bread, like for a family, you know, a couple of, in the first, you know, months. Then it started to get worse, you know. By the first months, like a couple of loaves of bread, and in the ghetto was then a kitchen, a soup kitchen. You could go there and get a bucket, you know, you had to bring your own dish to get soup with a lot of more water than soup, with green leaves. And sometimes you used to find in the soup a piece of beef, but not from a cow. It was from horse meat.
We'll stop now for a minute. Okay. talking about the ghetto, and I'd like to go back a little and have you tell me about the house that you lived in.
In the ghetto?
Mm-hmm.
In the ghetto was a small, gentle people lived there before in that house, and they had to move out because there was planned for the ghetto. So the gentle people didn't have a big saying against the Germans either. Mm-hmm. It was an order that section has to be cleared out by all gentle people. And by luck, we got that small little house. And we were a family, at that time, 6 people. So we got that little house, which was not far from our original house, we believed. And that was all told by the Jewish committee where we have to go. Each Jewish family was given orders by the Jewish committee with a number where they are going to stay and where they are going to leave. Because otherwise it would be a chaos if everybody would run and just grab houses. Everybody got a certain little letter, an order. You are going to live right near Ariogalos Girls Street, or near Panera Street.
Were you given a specific house assignment also?
Yes, they gave you a specific place with the address where you got to go and live.
Was your family the only occupants of this house?
Yeah. But near our house was another little houses, and it was other families. And then was bigger houses, was occupied by 2-3 families. Mm. And if the house was a lot bigger, was 4 and 5 families. But that was particularly, we were lucky, it was a very small house, and it was only like for 5-6 people to live.
Was there heat in the house? Or?
No, it was like old-fashioned iron little stove. You had to throw in something to cook. But at that time, it was not winter yet anyhow. Mm-hmm. It was August, so it was not too cold. But in order to cook, my mother used to take a couple of pieces of wood, make a little fire, add a little iron grill. Excuse me. And she used to cook. We didn't have facilities in the ghetto, you know, like electric ovens or something, like real modern equipment. All Slabodka was not modern equipped.
Was there electricity?
Yes, was electricity.
Was there any health care in the ghetto?
Yeah, then it opened up like a couple of weeks later, after the ghetto was established, opened up a little hospital. And Dr. Kaplan, Mrs. Kaplan, and a lot more doctors were taking care of sick people. Didn't have too much of medicine because the Germans already, you know, started to cut down on medications. But all the doctors, when they left their homes or the hospitals where they worked before the war, they went and they got big amounts of medicines to bring in the ghetto. So it was a little stack of medicine. Maybe it lasted a year or 3/4 of a year. Then it started to get short on medicine. And they had to beg, the committee had to beg the German Gestapo to bring at least, you know, the important medicines against epidemics, against different typhuses, or aspirins was an important medicine. And the Germans at that time, you know, need needed some people still to work for them too. So they gave small amounts of medicine. But if a man was real terrible sick, the chance was not too good.
Were there epidemics in the ghetto?
In the ghetto, no, it was no epidemics. The ghetto, in the later years, people started to die from hunger. Mm-hmm. But as I recall, as I remember, it was not an epidemic in the ghetto.
So people in the Kovno ghetto were basically staying alive and able to work.
Yes, if they didn't die from bad illnesses or hunger. Mm-hmm. Or the main thing, of course, selections. That was the main problem. You didn't know any morning or any night when the trucks are going to drive in with the green uniforms, with the rifles, with the machine guns. Raus! Raus! Everybody out. So you went to sleep with that fear, and you got up with that fear.
Was there any comfort?
No, it was no comfort. Because we were thinking that is Hitler's program to liquidate all the Jews, as many as he can. First in Europe, and then in the other parts of the world, even the United States. Because I had Germans, which I used to do certain things for them when I worked in the Werkstätten. We used to sometimes making terrible jokes with me. He says, "Don't be worried, Moses. We are going to have other Hutterners in the future more. We are going to have even American Hutterners. Not only Lithuanian Hutterners, we are going to have American Hutterners." So I knew what he meant. He meant, I mean, they're going to take the whole world. In 1941, the German country and the German soldiers, that they really believed that Germany is going to take over the whole world. I mean, the power and all their taking country after country, the blitzkrieg with all the weapons and all the power, is that nobody will be able to stop him.
Was there any Jewish resistance in the ghetto?
No, there was no resistance. Maybe the last half a year or maybe the last year of the ghetto start to be organized, the Zionist organization, Mizrahi and Apoel organization, start to organize themselves quietly and have meetings how to sabotage the German army, how to do damage towards the German soldiers. But it was not with big results. But then start to get big contacts, these organizations in the ghetto, with the outside of the ghetto. That was the last years of the war. In the woods, in the forests, where a lot of partisans, Russians, regular army Russian partisans, they were with parachutes, you know, down in the forests in Lithuania. And they got contact, the Jewish organizations in the ghetto, 3-4 organizations with the partisans outside the ghetto, communications. And then slowly, little by little, a lot of Jews start to sneak out from the ghetto, and they had already contacts, and they went in the woods, and they were working with the Russian, with the Soviet partisans against the Nazis. I had a friend of mine, he was maybe a couple of years older than me, his name was Slapok, two brothers. Slapok, very strong, athletic boys, and they got in contact with certain, you know, partisans, and the partisans gave these two boys orders to take railroads, dynamite the railroad rails. And these two boys, my friends, the two brothers Slapoks, killed, I wouldn't exaggerate, thousands of German soldiers who used to come by train, you know, transport soldiers. The two boys were dressed like peasant boys, Lithuanians, like farmer boys, with shovels, wearing like they work on farms. And they were experts, trained by the Russian partisans in the woods, out to dynamite the trains. And they took a lot of trains, of the rails. And they are still living there in Israel, the two boys.
Do you remember their first names?
One name was Rufke. Rufke. And Benjamin, Ben. Rufke and Ben, two brothers. After the war, they went to Israel. And what they did in the war against the Nazis, when the Israelis had problem with the Palestinians, they were a big help there too.
Okay.
That's what, but they, these boys, dynamite, a lot of soldiers were flying in the air. And these boys used to grab live Germans, soldiers, and they used to hang them and with a sign, this is for the Jewish blood, and hide himself back in the woods.
How did you know this?
Because I was with these two boys after the war in the same place. Uh-huh. After the war, when we were liberated, you understand? And I was in Germany, and I was in that kibbutz, in that villa, in that Dorfmarkt. These two boys were sent in to live in that mansion from that big Nazi. Because they were, that was a place, a preparation to immigration for Israel. And there where I met the two boys, and they showed me all kind of things and medals and everything.
Did you think to join the resistance movement?
I wanted to join, but I think I didn't want to leave my mother. I didn't have a heart. My father would be alive, I would have joined it. But I didn't have no father, and my mother and the family didn't have that heart to leave her alone.
Was there any good time in the ghetto?
No.
Was there any music?
Only good time was if you got an extra loaf of bread by mistake. Or you got a piece of butter in trading with a Gentile person who gave you, you know, like a kilo of butter for a fancy golden ring. So you were lucky, because a lot of times you traded with them and you were not lucky, because it had to be a fast trade. Guards were all the time watching you, so it had to be traded fast outside the ghetto. Mm-hmm. And one time my mother gave a woman, she was working, my mother, outside of the ghetto in a factory where they were slaughtering chickens for the German army. And an old lady, which I hate to say, with a big cross too, was trading with my mother. And my mother gave her a ring, and it was in the winter time, very cold, and the woman gave her, in a paper, wrapped up a big piece of butter, supposed to be. And mother was happy. Wow. She got for that little ring a nice big piece of butter. But when she came home and we opened up the paper and we cut it in, was a big stone inside. Mm. The butter was only smeared around the stone. And the German woman got away with the ring, and we got just a thin covering and a stone with butter. That was done by a Gentile, Lithuanian, old lady with a cross.
Did your mother keep her wedding ring?
Yes. My mother kept her wedding ring. She would never give up that. Two things in the crematorium she had to give up is my little brother. And the ring was pulled off before she went to the crematorium.
She kept it.
Actually, she didn't give up my little brother. She went with him on the lap. But I mean, she...
I know what you mean. When you say your mother worked outside of the ghetto, the Jewish people were mixing with the Gentile population?
In secretly, everything.
Secret. Were the Jews identified as Jews? Were they dressed differently, or were
no,
they...
No, the Jews had to wear that Jewish style.
What do you mean?
Jewish people who worked, were in the ghettos, they used to go out of the ghetto. You were all the time had to wear that Star of David. That was the order in the ghetto.
That was the order given once you were in the ghetto? Or
no,
before?
It was before the ghetto. It was July the 12th.
That order was given?
July the 12th was given that order that every Jew must wear a star. If they are caught without a star, they are going to be shot immediately.
Where did you get the star?
Everybody had to make stars. Material, you went to the committee if you didn't have. Or you went to friends. And you had to find yellow material, one got from the other, and you made stars.
And did they have to be a certain size?
Yes, it was a certain size, the star. I think it was like a 3.5 inches, I don't know, in centimeter now, by 3.5 inches. Almost like 4 inches stars.
And it was sewn onto your clothing?
On the left side. Right, actually, on your heart.
Mm-hmm. I see.
So when people walked out, you know, as they were walking outside of the ghetto, you were still wearing the star. Unless you took a terrible chance and you took off the star. So you could go in a lot of more areas, because the Germans then didn't know if you're Jewish or not. But they took a big chance. If another Lithuanian would notice that you are Jewish and you are not wearing the star, she would right away give you out. She would call a German and say, hey, here is a Jew there without a star. and you were taken and you were shot.
Were the Lithuanians in any way rewarded for turning in Jews, or is it just...
No, they were not rewarded.
They just wanted to.
I wouldn't say all Lithuanians did it, but comparing with other countries, they were experts of killing Jews. Lithuania is known for not killing only the Lithuanian Jews. They begged the Germans, the Gestapo, to bring Jews from other countries, and they'll have the pleasure to kill them. And that's what it was. I've seen transport from Germany and from other countries, the trucks taken to the Ninth Fort, and they were killed. And the Lithuanians had the biggest pleasures. The Germans were smoking the cigars and cigarettes, and the Lithuanians with the machine guns proudly finished up only not the Lithuanian Jews, but German Jews, and I think Hungarian Jews too. And I think French Jews too.
When was
but
that?
German Jews I know for sure, because some of the clothing too fell off from the trucks, and Lithuanians finding the pockets, you know, clothing. And some of the clothing from the German Jews were sent in the ghetto in magazines to give out clothing for the Jews in the ghetto. And some Jews in the ghetto, Mr. Segelson, who was the chief, you know, in the clothing department and in the department of the Oldwerkstätten, was Mr. Segelson. He hesitated to release from that magazine the German clothes to the Lithuanian Jews because he didn't want to, you know, the tragedy should become bigger. So it was kept in locked magazines in the ghetto. That's what the Lithuanians did.
How long were you in the ghetto?
In the ghetto, we were from August 15 until July the 13th, 1944. From 1941, August the 15th, until July the 13th.
And what happened in 1944?
In 1944, they started to liquidate. The Soviet army started to get closer and closer, chasing. The Germans started to lose the war, and they started to retreat from all over, from Russia. Since Stalingrad, you know, they started to go all the way down.
Did you know what was happening? Did you have news of the war?
The last couple of years, we knew it.
How did you get news?
We got information, you know, from some Lithuanians who had, you know, the special radios, and some Jewish people worked for Lithuanians who were Lithuanians and Germans. They were like Volksdeutsch. They lived in Lithuania, but they were Germans, and they used to call themselves Volksdeutsch. And one German, a Volksdeutsch, his name was Genske. And he had a brigade of Jewish workers working for him in his machine shop outside of the ghetto because he was working for the German army. Mm-hmm. And he was wearing the brown, you know, band with the swastika. And he had a license to take out like 20 Jews to work for his shop. He was a Volksdeutsch. The matter of fact, my father knew him very well, that Genske. And that Genske gave all the time the news secretly to a couple of the men who worked for him. And Genske knew how the war goes, where the losses are, where the second front is, and America entered the war, because we really didn't know the big war between the United States and Japan. We really didn't know too much about that. We didn't know, we knew when the United States entered the war direct with Germany, but not too much. We didn't know. Because when we were in the barracks in Dachau, we used to cry and say, where are the Americans? Are they sleeping? What's happening? Because people are skeletons, we were dying like flies. Where are the Americans? We didn't know exactly. The Americans are falling like flies themselves in the war. Thousands of American good men with aeroplanes are being shot down, killed, murdered. I lost my cousins in Italy, you know, an NGO. Fall dead, you know, got killed in the war. We didn't know about those things. We were just crying in Dachau. Where are they? Why doesn't they come to help us?
So in the ghetto, you were beginning to see the turn in the war that the Soviets
were... Yeah, we saw that. After Stalingrad, the Germans became faster to liquidate Jewish population all over in Europe.
And they began the notification.
Because they start to feel already that it's got to be sped up faster. It's got to go with a big tempo. Because they saw after Stalingrad that Himmler, especially him, he started to feel and to pledge, you know, the pledge he had in his heart to rainwash, to clean all the Jews as much as he can. And it started to work very fast, to liquidate the Jews in the ghettos.
Let's stop now for a moment. Mm-hmm. Up until the time of the liquidation of the ghetto, you were still working as a wood turner?
Yes, I was working in the Werkstätten, in the workshops in the ghetto, until to the last actual day when they start to take us to that gate to transport to Germany.
Did you have any extraordinary experiences with your work?
Oh, yes. I had a lot of experiences while I was working in the Werkstätten. As I recall, in 1941, when the Werkstätten, I think it was around December, before Christmas, the German commandant from the Werkstätten and the ghetto, Commandant Widman was his name, Widman, W-I-E-D-M-A-N-N. He was the commandant and taking care and checking out how the workshops work and how everybody's manufacturing things and how all the work is going on. And if everything goes through, you used to come all the time and check out how all the workers are working. And he was very happy all the time seeing that the leather coats by the tailors are coming out excellent, and the leather boots are the most beautiful work he ever seen. And the German uniforms are made excellent to order for the biggest type of people and the older people, and the toy factory is doing a golden job. So one day, one of his friends who had vacation from the Russian front, one of his comrades, he invited to show off. He was the big leader with that swastika, you know, carrying on with the ghetto. He was showing off his friend all the job he's doing with the Juden, with the Jews, and with the work. So he took him on a tour, that German, his friend, who came for vacation from front, from the Russian front. And he started walking him through the workshops. The German, his friend, when he came in, he was angry like a lion, like a tiger. He had in his hand a leather strap, like the German fair, you know, when they beat people. He didn't know who to cut and who to slice over the head, you know, with that strap. The way he was walking through all the yard and the factory, like a monster. That's how angry he was. And Mr. Widman was just going with him. He didn't say a word, you know. But then he came into my department, right from the yard. We all looked through the window. We saw the hanger. And we all started to walk right by the lights, you know. First, he's coming in into our shops. And he walked in. We saw the anger on his face. And he looked. And then he walked by my lathe. At that time, I was turning a chess set from little bones. And it's called a pocket chest set. It's so small, the figures, that you put them in, you know, with little pins. It's turned on each figure from the chest. It's turned on a small little pin and in a little box, with a chair set and you stick in and you play like that and you can keep in your pocket. A beautiful job, I turned the chair set. And he looked at the lathe, the way I turn and the white shavings from the figures, you know, fall right on my lathe and the way I shape it. And he looked, and at that time I was young and I had very blonde hair. I mean real blonde. Now I'm gray, so you would never know. But you'll see the pictures there when I was young, real blonde. And he saw the way I was turning my chair set. He looked again at my face, and he came closer to me, and he said to me, "Are you a Jew?" I said, "Yes, I'm Jewish." He says, "But your father was not a Jew." I said, "My father was Jewish, my mother is Jewish, and my grandfather are Jewish. And we're all woodturners. And in German it's called Drechslers. They're all Drechslers," and I told him in German. "Wir sind alle Drechslermeisters." So he said in German, "Aber das gibt doch nicht." That means, it couldn't be. It couldn't be that Jews people can do that type of work. And while his friend, you know, the commandant, was marching around there, not standing even close by him, he was marching on in another direction, that German murderous man who came in started making conversation with me. He said again, "Aren't you making a mistake?" I says, "No, we are all Jews." He says, "How could it be? The Jews know only one thing. We were taught by the Führer, and we were taught in our schools, and we were shown pictures what the Jews do. They are Deute, Deute people, and they do only swindle jobs. They are not workers. They don't have no trades. They are not tradespeople. So how could it be that all this, your whole family were all woodturners? That means something is wrong somewhere. So that means," it says, "the Führer said a lie. And all my leaders are lying." That's why he was talking to me quietly, right by the lake. "Ah," he says, "it couldn't be." And he looked again at me, and I said to him, "When you go through all the other departments, you'll see shoemakers, tailors, and uniforms, the most beautiful things, and all made by Jews. In Lithuania and in all the Baltic countries, and even in Poland, the best shoemakers and the best tailors and the best cabinet makers and the best carvers and the best woodturners are all Jews." He says, "Oh, aber das habe ich nicht gewusst." He said, "This I didn't know." And it took one of my figures, what I had on the lathe turned, and he took out a small pen, and he says, "If you don't mind, put down your name underneath the figure, write your name." So it was so small, you know, that I had to make small, like very thin writing. I put down Moses, M-O, all around the figure, and the bottom, M, Moses, and he put it in his pocket. He says, "I'm going to show it to my comrades when I go back to Germany. The beautiful work the Jews are doing for the German Reich. And I'm going to also tell them," he says, that the Führer said some lies." And he was talking very quietly. And when he left, he threw a pack of cigarettes right under my lathe. And he was no more running around with his leather strap and looking like a murderer. He had such a change in his face that he was not the same man. And I had a couple of times similar cases during the wartime with certain officers like him, because there's a lot of German SS who became so devoted because they never lived in with Jews. They came from some of them came from towns where they never saw a Jew. They saw Jews only in the propaganda school. Then they became SS soldiers. How the Jews looks like rats with beards, with all different things. So they never met Jews. And then all of a sudden, Lithuania is a country that the Jewish people are different than other countries, like different than Poland. Very few Jews. My grandfather wore a beard. Other couple of Jews wear beards. But mostly Lithuanian Jews were smoothly shaved, and they didn't have beards, and they didn't wear hats. The same thing like in the United States, people. Clean, shaved, cut, nicely dressed, and without hats. And the Germans didn't know that. Some of the Germans, the old Germans, SS, they knew because they lived with Jews and they went in schools and in colleges with Jews. But the young German generation, SS, some of the hooligans, learned only our Jew looks. And when they came in and they see clean-cut Jews in the ghetto, when we were in the ghetto, we were still nicely dressed because we were still had our clothes. We were not in striped uniforms. And we were not 100% in our skeletons. And we still had our hair. We were not shaved like in the concentration camp. So when those Germans saw how Jews look, so they thought, these Jews look almost like we look. Understand? So they had, some of them had already little opinions and little, you know, changes of their thinking. I couldn't, you know, make tank the old SS troops like that. I wish I could. Believe me, I don't know if I could change them. But some of them were in a lot of disappointments, seeing what Jewish hands can do. And he took that little chess figure with him right in the pocket. And then he kept on going through further up, I didn't see him anymore, to other departments of the workshops. And a lot of the tailors, my uncle was a tailor, he told me. I said, did a man was a hooligan who came in your department? He said, no, he was very quiet and he was standing still. I said, yes. I think I was the first one who calmed him down, maybe. So, I mean, this is a piece of history you can never forget.
It might have saved some lives.
Maybe. I'm telling you.
When they began to liquidate the ghetto,
yes.
What were you thinking? What did you...
We were thinking that we are going to be killed. We are taken to a place somewhere, or in Germany, or somewhere in Lithuania, in the outskirts, and we didn't know where we were going. But we were from the last group, my family, before me, in the morning, were taken already a lot of Jews to the train, to the railroad station. But we were still, you know, pushing ourselves to be the last. Maybe a miracle will be. So I was in the Werkstatt, actually, till the last maybe 400 or 500 Jews were on the place. We were no more in the Werkstatt. We were taken to the gates, but we were from the 400 or 500 the last Jews. I'll tell you the thing, when the Werkstatt were closed, a German Gestapo truck came in to pick up some laundry in the, because it was a laundry department. And nobody was there in the Werkstatt no more. Everybody was already gone, you know, to the transport, to the trailer, to the railroad. But I was still there with my family in the Werkstatt yard, because in the Werkstatt yard was a Maline. A Maline means there was a cellar dug out by some people who worked in the Werkstatt during the years, a hiding place. And one of the Jewish police who were all the time in the Werkstatt gate, staying all the time, was a very good friend of my uncle Boris. And he told me, his name was Janke Glick, Jacob Glick. He says, Meshale, your mother is here and children, let's go underneath. There's a Maline, a bunker in the ground with a certain hiding place to hide. and will go under there, and maybe will wade out. The Russians, the Soviet army, is not far from Lithuania. In weeks, Lithuania is going to be liberated by the Russians. So we crawled in that with my family, my mother and my brother and sister, inside. But other people maybe knew about that bunker too, and life is very dear, everybody wants to stay alive. So more people with force, I want to go in too, I want to be alive too. So everybody started to press himself in that bunker, in that Maline, called in Jewish is a Maline. The Maline was not big enough to take so many people, and my mother and even me, we started to feel like we were going to faint there. If we are not going to die by the Germans' guns, we are going to die here in the hall. So my mother says, let's go out. So we went out from the Maline and we walked all the way towards that Platz near the gates where everybody was together for the transport to the trailways, to the railroad. And we were from the last people to actually march out from the ghetto by the guards, the German guards with the machine guns, taken marching all the way to the railroad station. But before we marched out from the gates, from that Platz there, the Germans were burning, was a two-story house. I don't know if it was a medical clinic right near the gate, what it was there, or offices. And they took a man, a Jewish man there. They lit it, that place in fire. And while it was burning, they took a man. His name was Lipzer. And that Lipzer was a Jew who worked for 2-3 years for the Gestapo. He worked inside in the offices there. I don't know what type of work he did, if he was, you know, a double-crosser, you know, a man, you know, he gives out, you know, certain information to the Gestapo. We didn't know. Nobody can tell real the truth what he was working there in the Gestapo, if he was just cleaning windows, or it was, we didn't know for years he was working there. But the fact is, before liquidating the ghetto, they took Lipzer, that man I saw with my own eyes, and they marched him in the burning house, they pushed him in there, and he burned with the house together, with a lot of more other people were there. Sick people, you know, people who couldn't walk, on the march, so we walked in that house there on the left side of the gate. I don't know exactly what exactly it was in that house there. It was administration or something. And while we were walking, the house was burning. And that's how we were walking all the way to the railroad under heavy guard. And while we were walking under heavy guard, and this time the guard was real heavy. It was not playing rifles. It was machine guns they had. All the green uniform, SS or NKVD, I don't know what department of the German army it was. NKVD, I think it was. It's like the SS. The sad situation was, while we were taken to the railroad, the German army, the Wehrmacht, was retreating too. They were already being chased by the Soviet army. We were going to the railroad, and the German army was running for their lives to save themselves, the Wehrmacht. And I've seen, like I told you before, the shiny German army, who I thought they were going to take the world with the shiny boots, drinking the champagne, with the uniforms, being kissed by the Lithuanian girls. I've seen the same German army running without boots, crawling, dirty, torn clothes. They were laying on the sidewalks and on the streets, and I heard with my own ears while going through. The officer told one of the German soldiers from the Wehrmacht in German, "Get up. Don't forget you are a German soldier. Shame on you. Up." But the man couldn't get up, the soldier. Yet his legs were all blown up, torn. He didn't have boots even on his feet. And I said to my mother, and my mother started crying too. We're all crying. We are seeing the end. We are seeing the revenge. We are seeing the downfall of the Third Reich. Look how they're looking. Look at them. And we are marching on to the railroad, to the cattle trains. The German falling army, they needed the cattle trains to save their life more than we. They didn't give them the cattle trains to save them and run with them back to Germany. They had to walk and fall in the streets, the German army, running, because they were chased not to be caught by the Soviet army. For us, the air trains, the cattle trains, but the Wehrmacht was falling in the street, couldn't walk. Looked like dirt. They looked like the Russian prisoners. When the Germans marched in 1941, they made the Russian prisoners to look so beaten. When I looked at the Russian prisoners in 1941, I said, they don't look no more like humans. They were beaten, you know, with the butts from the guns by the German army. They beat them. They made them dirty looking, and they marched the Russian army to the main corner streets to show the Lithuanians, the gentle people, look at what we did with the Russian army, showing off in 1941, 1944, July the 13th. They were looking worse than the Russian army. I mean, not so angered out on the faces, but the clothes, the shoes, torn, running. You understand? So I said, my mother was crying. She says, "Kinder, look. We are seeing," it says, "the nekama. That means we are seeing the revenge of them. And we are going to be, I'm afraid, killed." And that was the outcry by many, not only our family, by many families. It was the pleasure to see them running, falling in the street, the German army. And where are we going? What's going to be with us? We don't know. Some of our friends, after crossing from Slabodka to Kovno, there is a bridge, because underneath was the Vilia, that's a lake flowing. So it was an iron bridge, a small bridge to cross over. A lot of the people, of the Jewish people, jumped over the bridge in the water, maybe to save themselves. But nobody was saved. The German guard was so strong, and they all machine gunned them. And we were all taken to the railroad, and we were all start pushed in like cattle with such a force, with such a murder, anger to the railroad cattle cars, not like human beings. Everything was, that's why I use a lot of that word, chased. We were never, when it came to these type situations, we were all the time chased, not walked. One was falling on top of the other, in the trains. And I told my mother, before we went into the trains, because I spoke with some of my friends when we left the ghetto, to my friend Jan Kalevitz, Biyomkevitz, his brother, Chayet, another Inge, and Davidson, a Inge, four guys. We made up our mind when we are in the train, if we are going to go by train, we knew we are going to the railroad. But if we are going to the certain place we were thinking we are going to jump the train. So I didn't want to go in the same train with my mother and with my brother and with my sisters, with my family, in case by jumping I'll be shot. I didn't want my mother to see that. So I went in another car with my friends, with a lot of other people, you know. And
okay, let's stop for a minute right here.
Yeah.
Okay. Mr. Rich, you're boarding the train.
Yes.
And you decide to go on a different car from your mother?
That's right. Because I was afraid if I'm going to jump and I'll be shot and she may notice through somehow Rosalie machine guns, still think, you know, I don't want to see if something happened to me. So I went in that car. But the train started to roll. The doors were locked in the cattle trains. And we went close to that little window with small little irons on the car, the cattle car, you know. And we pulled it off. It was not heavy wires, and my friend, the first one, Biyomke, which pushed through the head, and he jumped. He was the first one, he jumped. And soon he jumped, we heard machine guns. We didn't hear no more like the regular train. We heard heavy, like from 5-6 machine guns. We didn't know on the roof of the train, the SS with heavy duty machine guns. They're all placed. And another situation is the same like we planned to jump from the train. And where did we jump? We knew where to jump. We were jumping when we came to an area, it's called Kozlova Ruda. We knew in these forests are the Soviet partisans. And soon we jump from the train near this area. We are going in the woods and we are in the saved with our lives, there in the Soviet army. And there was already a lot of Jewish people, the last people from the ghetto, who were in this wood working with the partisans together, shooting, you know, the German army in the back. But when I heard the machine guns and in other cattle trains, some other people had the same idea too, that they came to the forest. Not only we had the idea, other young people had the same idea too. So when it was a lot of shooting, the train stopped. The Germans stopped the train. They opened up the doors from the cattle train. They walked in, they pushed themselves in because it's so loaded that it was hard for 2-3 people to go in there. We were all at a stand. There was no place to sit down. And they took out from each cattle train like 3-4 people. They laid them down in the side of the railroad and they killed. And they said, everybody through the trains. And they opened up the gate. You see here? If you're going to jump and try any other things, you're all going to be shot like that. And then, after the people were shot, when they took out the living people from the train, they threw him in back in the trains. So we lived with dead people. They were driving off to Germany in the train, in the cattle trains. My mother stood a little by the door too, and further up she saw another boy dragging in who was shot from far away. She didn't, and he looked like me a little too, like a blonde, skinny guy like me. She started hysterically crying. My brother and sister couldn't stop helping crying. She says, Maisky State, Morris is dead. I saw him, they were dragging him. They were dragging him in the train, he's dead. I know Maisky's head. I know that's him. Children said, no, that was not him, that was another guy who looks like Maisky. And to that day, I feel very sorry because my mother died in her mind that I was shot at that transport and I was in the other cattle trades there. My sister and my brother, and when my sister met my mother in Auschwitz, before my mother was cremated, my mother said, what says is my life? Maisky stayed anyhow. I saw him the way they dragged him. I don't care no more for my life what's happening. Because she was already in Studov a couple of weeks, no food, nothing. They took away her shoes. And with my little brother, took away the whole spirit. She was no more human. They made her no more to be a human being. So my mother told Feiglin, my sister, and Mirken, my other sister, yes, she says, Maisky State, I am dead. And that bothers me a lot of times. Mm-hmm. And the cattle train was closed again, all the doors back, and it kept on rolling and rolling and rolling. And all the time it rolled, we were all figuring we are seeing dead in front of us. Mm-hmm. In the daytime, when we passed by and I looked through the little holes and I saw big factories with big chimneys, I said, yeah, I think that's the place. I think this we are going to be cremated.
Why did you think you'd be
because
cremated?
We knew already the last years that it was crematoriums. We knew in the ghetto. The first years of the war, we didn't know about crematoriums. But the last half a year in the ghetto, before liquidations, we had rumors. You know, rumors travels. Mm-hmm. When one escapes, when one German is drunk, and it talks, you know, rumor started. We knew the last half a year in the ghetto that they had crematoriums in Poland and in other places, and people are cremated by the thousands and by the hundreds of thousands. So anytime, excuse me, when I passed and I looked through the little cracks while the train was rolling and I see a factory, I said, oh, I think the train is going to stop here. That must be the crematorium with big chimneys, you know. but it was factors, you know. And I looked at it in other places, the fields. You see, it was in July 14, you know, July 13, July 14, the weather was nice. We started going further already to Germany. The farmers and the fields and the cows and the beautiful nature. And I looked through the window and I says, what a beautiful world. And we are all going to be killed. And tears came to my eyes. I said, beautiful world. Yeah. I said, look, why does these people live? Look at the farms and the fields, and the animals and the cows and the hay and the plants. Why are we different? Why are they taking us to kill us?
Did the train stop at all?
It stopped at certain stations, you know, like railroad changing or something like that. Because it stopped in one place, and I had a little metal can. It was maybe beef before in that can. It was laying in the train somewhere else. And I pushed through a little can, and a woman, a German woman, was standing there. And we were for a while there, maybe 20 minutes or 15 or 25 minutes. The train was, I don't know, maybe getting something, food for the Germans or something. And I pushed through the hole, that little can, to give me water, because a lot of dead people are already in the train from thirst. And my mother, when we left the ghetto, gave us some money. And my mother cut in my leather boots here. I was wearing leather boots like that, tall boots. She cut a little opening, and she pushed in rubles. And I think a couple of Swiss francs and a couple of dollars, American money, my mother had. We were poor people, but my mother was secretly a saving all the time, you know, on the side. I think I got her nature, understand? And she said, children, you never know when this can help you sometimes. She gave it to me. She gave it to my brother, and she gave it to my sisters. And I pulled out a paper bill. I don't know even what it was, if it was a ruble or a Swiss franc or a dollar, or American dollar. I know it was a paper money, and I pushed through that little crack, and I said to the lady, give me a little water in the can. And I wasn't surprised. She brought me water in a rusted can. While I was drinking the water, people were jumping at me. They almost killed me to get just one lick of the water. And from the water, I almost had maybe not even an eighth of a can. I was licking the can of the water till I actually came to Dachau. I was licking the can with my tongue. It was no more water. It was actually dried out, that can, and I was still leaking. I thought maybe from a crack, it's rusted and bent, maybe a drop of water will come out. I think maybe I was hallucinating. I think so. But I start to think now that the can was so dried out, and I was still going in with my mouth and my tongue, I think it was hallucinating that the can still, it'll make water, or it has water. And I kept that little can in my hand till I arrived in Dachau. When I arrived in Dachau, then I met my brother. My mother was separated on the train in Stutthof, maybe a day before we came to Dachau. They took out a lot of, stopped the train, Stutthof, and they took out all the women and children from the trains, and they took them to that, to the crematoriums of Stutthof. Excuse me.
And they took your sister also at
yeah,
that time?
Yeah, my sisters too.
Both sisters?
Yeah. My little sister was too young. That's what I learned after the war. She was 13 years old. And when they took my mother with my brother and my little sister to the crematorium, they marched around. A transport of women was going to work. My mother took my little sister Miriam and she pushed her in the group of the women who were going marching on to work. And that's how my little sister remained alive. Otherwise, she would have gone in with my mother and little brother in the crematorium.
And where were they? They were at Auschwitz?
They were in Auschwitz, and then they took all the women to work. And then they took them in different camps. And that's how my sister remained, the young one, alive. Because my mother pushed her out from the line that they were taken to the crematorium, and they were marching on a transport of women going to work, not to the crematorium. So my mother gave her a push, and she says, "In!" And she pushed her in, and my little sister got all mangled up between the women who go to work, and the other women embraced her. And that's how my little sister, who is in Israel, remained alive.
And
the train rolled down. After they dropped off all the women in Stutthof, some of the women went in Stutthof and they remained alive because they were transported to working camps. Mm-hmm. But some of the women who had children who didn't want to give up the children, if my mother would have given away my little brother, she maybe would have remained and stayed alive too. Because women without children, they took a lot of them to different camps for work, mm-hmm. labor, slave labor. But my mother, the German came to her, he says, "Give me dein Kind." My mother said, "Nein, this is my baby, I don't give him away. I go where my baby goes." Pushed her on right with all the kids and with all the women and with the old people and with all the mothers with children, and she went right into the crematorium. Didn't want to give up my brother Solomon.
How did you know this story?
My sister Miriam told
me. She was there?
Yeah, my sister, yeah, she was killed, you know, hearing the stories, you know, from the other people. There was a lot of women in the camp where Kapos. That's right. But they told me, told my sister still remained in Stutthof like 4 or 5 days till they took him away in different camps. So my sister came back from work with the people. Where is my mother? So some of the police, you know, women there who worked, you know, with the Germans. I mean, they were there to do the job, you know. Some of the prisoners said, "My kind, my child, your mother marched on."
So you and your brother arrived at Dachau?
Yeah, we arrived in Dachau, and that was the 15th of July, 1941. And we were unloaded from the trains, and the commandant was by the railroad already with a group of SS, and with a heavy guard taken right by the train, and we marched on right to Dachau. And when we came to the gates from Dachau, the gates opened up, and we were chased. Again, I'm using the word chased, because you had to run all the time, because you didn't know where you're going to get hurt. Hans, schnell, schnell, all the time, schnell, you know, to make a big, you know, rush on you. You should not be able to think of anything. And When in and Dach on the gates closed, we were no more human beings. We were numbers, and we were dead people.
What did they do first?
First, they start to take away, they start cutting the hair. Take off your hair right away.
The first day?
Yeah. Excuse me. The first day, start to take away, cutting the hair first. Then they start to take away your clothes. Then they start to tell you to give away all valuables. And no play, no tricks. And don't swallow valuables. We have a way to find. They threw a very big scare on you. And they shot already a couple of people right away, the last 10 minutes, the first 10 minutes. To scare you, right away, they shot people for nothing, you know, in the Platz there, in the camp. And took away the clothes. Then you have to go, they gave you striped clothes. And then you went through, you know, through little tables there, and they gave you numbers on your clothes. My number was 81-840. My brother's number was 81-841, and so on and so on. And we got to close the concentration camp close. Excuse me. Then they took us to show us temporary barracks. They didn't have enough barracks. So they made temporary round, little, you know, like for Masonite with a roof. Temporary barracks. You belong eight, like the numbers, 855 belongs to number 4. That belongs to number 6. So we went to the little barracks. Was no floor. It was earth. And we were in the uniforms. We didn't have anything.
Excuse me.
And then it started, you know, all the murder situations, you know, beatings, hunger, no food. You didn't have, in 1 week, your spirit was broken, you were a nobody. And after 10 days, you start to see people dying in the yard. Germans, the commandant was a murderer, a killer. He was not a young man, I was surprised, you know. He was a man maybe 55 years old. He should have known the world. He must have learned what life is all about and human beings. He didn't know about those things.
What was his name?
Johann Kirsch. Johann Kirsch. We gave him a nickname. All the prisoners gave him a nickname. I'm a very bashful man to say that to you. But it's religiously, I gotta tell you, why I must say that name. He didn't call us Juden or other things. From the first day we marched in, he called us Aschlecher. You listen every word I say, you Aschlecher. Aschlecher is a bad word. He knows what it is, Aschlecher. In the United States, when I hear that word, I get very angry when people say, asshole. Mm-hmm. I cannot stand that word. When I hear somebody, I hear sometime on television, that word, my face gets red. So he had only one word. He called us that word. I'm not going to repeat no more. So we gave him that name. When we saw him coming in the camp from his quarters, we were relieved. We used to say, the Arschloch is coming. So everybody was on afraid, and everybody started to rush and hide himself. He killed people not with a pistol and not with rifles. He killed prisoners with his boots. That was his system of killing. Excuse me again. He knocked the people down on the ground, and as they laid on the ground, he kicked so much in the head that the man was dead. And that was his way of killing prisoners. He killed my friend, Moshe Balaban. I think I left it. He killed my friend, Moshe Balaban, because when we came from work one day, where we were working outside the camp, they took us to work in the Messerschmitt factory mall. And when we came back from work, before we go in through the gate, we had to take off the hats. And the Germans used to take guards by the gate, and they used to say, Mützen off! That means hats off. We had to first take off the hats. And then, Mützen on! You put back on the hat. So my friend didn't take off his hat, Moshe Balaban, so first the head. And he noticed that, because that Moshe Balaban was already sick. He was an older man, he was not a young fellow. Excuse me. He didn't take off the head first. And he took him out from the raw, you know, dropped him on the floor, and he kicked him so hard, killed him. Moshe Balaban died by Johann Kirs with his boots. He killed him. And that was the killing in that camp. And then the hunger was so big that people started, you were nothing, you know. Dying like flies. You get a piece of bread for a whole day with a little water, you get skinnier and skinnier, and you die. Everybody starts to become skeletons.
Did you work as a wood turner in Dachau?
No, not in the beginning. In the beginning, I worked in that place, mall, because they were building, they claimed, they are going to build there the secret weapon which is going to destroy the United States and the whole world, wherever they want to be destroyed. It's going to be built in that factory where they were building. It was working 24 hours steady. It's called Mall. And it was managed by the Tot company. I think it's T-O-D-D, Todd Company. They manage that manufacturing plant for the secret weapons they said they were going to make there. And it was going on day and night. Millions, hundreds of thousands of people died, you know, in these constructions.
What kind of work were you doing there?
I was working by the cement. After they were pumping from a station day and night cement for the roof, so American airplanes cannot bomb it through. So they were building roofs, rounded roofs, which it was the height approximately about 10 foot solid concrete roof, rounded. And the need was taken out with machines, all the oil, maybe 10 foot deep, taken out day and night oil for miles. And then when it was taken out all the oil, then was made with forms, roofs, but 10 foot thick of cement. So it had to pump day and night, that cement. And I was with a piece of wood with a long handle had to stomp the cement. It shouldn't fall in one place. To spread it.
Okay, let's stop now.
And that was the walk.
Mr. Rich, toward the end of the days at Dachau, what were you seeing? What was happening?
The last days of Dachau, they saw that the Germans are losing the war, because where I was working in that place, the American Air Force, the American airplanes were bombing Germany all over. And when the airplanes used to come, they used to have the sirens blowing the Germans to hide. Mm-hmm. Take off, you know, from your places and hide themselves in their place, in the bunkers there. There's a building for to make that secret weapon. All the Germans ran wild to save their lives. Even the guards used to run away, leave us alone, the prisoners, for them to hide, because they never knew when the bombs are going to fall. So we were without guards, but we couldn't run over us. We were so deep in Germany that you cannot run, and you're skeletons, you cannot do anything. But any time I looked up, while the Germans were hiding, and I saw the aeroplanes, the Americans, going heavy loaded with bombs. And I looked it up in the skies. I said, God bless you. You should all come safe home. And the aeroplanes used to let out, you know, the silver paper so they couldn't be spotted, you know, to shut them down, you know. Like, I forgot what it's called, you know, in the Air Force, those things, you know, like sliced silver, you know, shavings. Mm-hmm. So the guns cannot know if it's the aeroplanes to distract them, you know. But I saw the aeroplanes, some of them very little, because they were flying very high. And they were bombing somewhere in other places. But the Germans, the guards didn't know where, so they used to hide themselves. And I was so happy.
So this signaled more or less the end of the war for you?
Yeah, it signaled more the end of the war. When we saw bombed the airplanes all the time, we had to run. The Germans had to run, and we were left without guards. At a walking place, we knew. And the Germans were so nasty that time, they knew they were losing the war. So we knew it's the end. It's a matter of weeks.
And what happened?
We were counting the days. We didn't know what's going to happen to us. We still thought that if they lose, if before the Americans are going to liberate us, or whoever is going to liberate us, the Germans are going to shoot us. And that's what the plan was. The plan was all the prisoners from all the camps to be shot before the liberation. But thank God it didn't work out that way.
Well, what happened instead?
Instead, the main chief who had the order to liquidate all the prisoners from Dachau didn't give out the order. He wanted to save his own life. He knew the war is lost. And he figured if the Americans come in and he'll show that he had the order to shoot all the prisoners and he didn't release it, he's not going to be hung. He's not going to be punished. So that's how we were saved.
And what was his name?
I think his name was Martin Weiss.
What did he do with the prisoners?
The prisoners, after we were all chased for the dead march from Dachau all the way to the Tyrol Mountains in big caves, natural caves. All the prisoners from all the camps all around, not only Dachau, were placed in that valley, a natural valley near the Tyrol Mountains. Maybe 3-4 miles valley. Deep, you go deep and deep and deep. And all the machine guns were placed all on the top, ready to fire and shoot the people. And that was the May the 30th. We were all chased. May the 30th, we were chased day and night all the way from Dachau to the Tyrol Mountains. When we arrived to that valley, was May the 31st. May is got 31st day. Was May the 31st we arrived, and it was very dark in the nighttime, and we stumbled one on top of the others. It was so dark. Thousands of prisoners were already there from other camps. They were already there from brought before us. And I stumbled on a prisoner, walked on him because it was too dark. And he was a German prisoner. Must have been a politisch German prisoner. Mm-hmm. And he spoke in German to me. And he said to me, "Where are you coming from?" I says, "From Dachau." He says, "Yeah, I came from Dachau too, but from a prior transport, a couple of days before." He says, "Tonight," he says, "is our last night. Did you see the machine guns all around?" I says, "No, it's dark." We came, it was dark in the nighttime. He says, "In the morning, I think, you'll start the shooting." May the 1st, in the morning, it was snowing. Yeah. Because it's near Tyrol, the mountains. People are snowing there, even sometime in June, they have snow. Tyrol, there. It was snowing, we were freezing to death. People were dying there in the valley, one after the other. And in the morning when we got up, it's like little mountains with snow was lifting up, because we were all sitting, all crunched in like that. And then when the morning came and we started straightening us out, it's like little snow mountains. Thousands of them were lifting themselves. And we washed up the snow and we were all shaking, shivering. We were cold, wet, thin clothes. You know, concentration camp, mm-hmm. It's like clothes, like it's a shirt. Smoke was going from the human bodies, you know, from the water and the skin, what you still had left on your bodies. And we were looking around there, yeah, there were all on the top SS troops ready to shoot, ready to get the order to machine gun. There was a doctor not far from me, from Lithuania too, Dr. Bloomberg. and his son, and he was a German Jew, spoke fluently German. He came to one of the guards, and he had in his pocket the cross, you know, like a doctor's veil. Mm-hmm. He took out from his pocket, put it down on his arm, and he came to a guard, Lucky. And he says to the German guard, can I take out five of the prisoners that are about to die if they're not getting a little warmed, a little heat? Please, let me take him out. And right near that valley was a small little farm village. It's called Kyling. Kyling near Bad Tölz. The place was Bad Tölz. That was a place, Bad Tölz, where the German high officers used to come for vacation.
So did the doctor take you?
The doctor took five people. But then I saw him taken, and I knew him. I said, Dr. Bloomberg. So he was afraid. Because of me, I'm going to spoil the thing. Mm-hmm. So he showed me on the left side was a gutter, like water is going through, you know, from the little village into that valley, almost a 6 foot, you know,
like pipes,
you know, but made out of metal, tin. And it was open, and here was going the water from that little village, a farm village, from Kyling, the water. So Bloomberg said to me, I said, go in these pipes there. And it was like from him, like maybe 60 or 80 feet away, but he knew. So I bent myself down, I laid myself down, and I crawled to the pipes. And these pipes, maybe about 200 feet from that little farm house, what was going, I crawled through there. And it led me right to a little farmhouse. I knocked in the door, and a German girl opened the door. Go away, we'll be shot. The German said, SS is all around. I says, please help me, let me in. And I cried. And she saw too that the German, the Americans, are only 10 miles from Bad Tölz. And she was a very religious person. And maybe she had a mind that she was hiding a prisoner. She was not going to be shot. Because a lot of these German people and the farm people thought the American army are going to shoot them with machine guns like the Germans did. They didn't know what democracy was. So the two are going to all be shot. So she figured, I don't know what in her mind was. I'm not a judge and I'm not a god. But she says, come in schnell. Come in fast. She opened the door, and I came in very fast in that stable where the cows, 8 or 10 cows, were all standing right there and eating the hay. And when I walked in that stable, paradise, heaven, the warmth from the cows, from the hay, from that stable, from being frozen so many days, being chased through woods, cities, and from that valley all night in the snow and in the cold. When you walk in a stable from cows, people got to have experienced that, to be frozen and walking in a stable of cows. It's like adrenaline to your heart. The warmth took me around so much that I felt I'm going to fall asleep right now. And she was hiding me where the cows, you know, hid the hay, you know, from the wooden, you know, mm-hmm. I don't know in English how to call that. This.
A trough.
Trough. Thank you. The cows were eaten from the troughs. She said I should go under the troughs. And she covered me with hay. And when I was covered with the hay, under the troughs, in the stable, with the warmth, I said, maybe there is a God still. But what is it, my brother? I was thinking. What is it, Avremkin? My brother didn't have a chance to make it. It happened everything so fast, the situation, that he remained still in the valley there with all the 100,000 maybe prisoners.
How long did you remain?
So I was right there, hungry, and the warmth took me around, and the girl brought out a big piece of farm bread with a glass of hot milk, and I was more in heaven. And when I drank the milk and the bread, I'm ashamed to tell you, I fell asleep right under the cows. I didn't know what happened to me. I fell asleep. And I was right in the stable. By 5 o'clock in the morning, the girl came in the stable and she bumped on my shoulder and she said to me, "You there, Jew, the Americans are 3 miles from my farmhouse." I could hear already, like heavy duty, you know, machinery are already rolling the streets. And while I'm right there and the happiness is on my face, maybe I'm safe. All of a sudden, a thing happened it's hard to explain. I hear somebody knocking in the door, but with a big, healthy force fist knocking in the door with big, you know, bangs and speaking in German. "Mach auf die Tür!" Open the door. And I hear somebody walked in, and the girl says to that man who walked in, "It's a barn, you know, a farm. You have place there on the top, go up on the steps." And who do you think walked up on the steps? A assessman, a guard with his rifle and his aluminum dish, you know, I forgot, but the canteen, what they eat. I hear him walking with his boots up on the barn, on the top, taken off from his shoulder. I hear every move, the rifle on the floor, taken off his aluminum canteen. I hear the noise, and I said, "I'm in trouble. If that SS finds out that a prisoner is laying underneath, he's upstairs with his gun, with his rifle, I'm downstairs by the cows, I'm a dead man. I'm dead." But he was hiding himself. He asked the girl if she's got some clothes, civilian clothes. I hear in German he's talking to her. And she gave him some sort of a coat or something. And he must have left his clothes right there up. Then the girl came in again. Excuse me. The girl knocked me again on the shoulder quietly. She said, "Assessment is up. Don't say a word. Don't talk. Don't move. We're all going to be shot." She says, "The Americans are a mile for my house. It took maybe 20, I think, minutes, or 25. I don't know the time. I cannot tell you. But the time, to me, it would have been like a year. And she knocked me on the shoulder, opened the door. I opened the door. I walked out. The Americans are here. American soldiers, the trucks, the jeeps, the tanks, the ambulances, trucks, the Red Cross. Black people, I've never seen in my life, a black man in my life, soldiers. I looked at it. I said, where am I? What is it? What happened to my brother? And right away, American soldier came to me. He happens to be somewhere from Brooklyn. And he spoke a little Jewish. And he said, was binst du? Redst Yiddish? I said, yeah, I talk Jewish. I'm a Jew. He said, you're a Jew. Ich, id, ich. Cannot read, didn't talk to my Jews. Ich, id, ich. And right away, he gave me something to drink, like a soda or something to drink. And he took right away a round little box, and he peeled off. And he took out like a brown piece of cake, like a donut. Eat. And my hand was shaken. And another soldier came and he gave me chocolate. And another chocolate said, give him better the beans, it's warm still. A can of white beans, all you know, army food. And all that came with photographs, with cameras, and started taking my picture. And I cried. I says, what are you, what? And then a Polak came, a soldier, who was talking Polish. He said to me, resume is po polsku. I'm Polish. You understand Polish? I said to him, I understand a little bit. And then another one came who talk already better Yiddish. You understand? Jewish. And I said, go fast right in that valley. It's 10 minutes from here. There's 100,000 maybe prisoners to be shot. And my brother is there. And they gave a run with the cars and with the jeeps all around that place there. And before they ran, and they ran away, and still a lot of soldiers, and the black man was looking at me and he gave me candy. And I looked, I said, I never seen a black man, you know, and I was so interesting for me to see these type of people. And they gave me so much food, and I had a big, you know, torbe, like a big, what the Germans wear, you know, on their shoulder, rucksack.
Oh.
You know, I got a rucksack. The girl gave me from the farm a rucksack. She threw me out. They saw she's giving me all that food. So she threw out the rucksack. She gave it to me. And they loaded me up with food, and I ate so much I couldn't eat no more. And they took pictures, and they didn't know what to do, the American soldiers, to me. And I grabbed one soldier and I kissed him. And then I forgot all about. I said to the soldier, there's a SS man hiding himself upstairs. I was so confused. I was so out of this world that my main enemy, my guard, the SS man is upstairs sitting there and hiding himself. He thinks he's going to get away with murder. So I said to one of the American soldiers who spoke already Jewish almost fluently. I think he spoke Jewish better than English. He must have been maybe from the Delance Street. I mean, real good. Oy, I'm so verklemmt. And I still got to talk, you know, a little Jewish and to explain, yeah. You know, you don't, maybe don't understand. But I'm telling English. The soldier, the American soldier, came up, and he ran with such a speed, and he took off his gun, and he said, Americans, down! And he said to me to tell him. He called me too. I said, go with him. Tell him to go down. And I told him in German, the gays stormed here. Schnell. The Americans in here. Go down, the American soldier is here. And the American soldier said to him, he knew in English that soldier to say, with the hands up. And he came from the steps, down like that, with a big coat, the girl found somewhere, a torn up coat, and underneath it was almost naked, because he threw away all the uniform there. All wrapped up in that coat like that, and he walked, and he told him again, hands up, and he was afraid, you know, the coat is going to fall off of him or something. And the American almost shot him because he started to move his hand. And he was going like that. And it took him right downstairs. And while it took him downstairs, he said to me, that American soldier, I wish I knew who it was. I should have taken his name. I would kiss, I would hug him. I wouldn't know what to do with that man. He said to me, what's your name? I said, Moshe. He said, in America we call you maybe Morris, or maybe Marty, or maybe Mo. Meruvdir. He said in Jewish. He says, Morris, if you want to knock his face off, do it right now. Beat him. That is yes, man. I was a skeleton. I weighed about 68 pounds. Almost like 33 kilos. That was my weight. Kilogram, almost. 68 pounds or 64 pounds. I got to look it up from Schwabing, because they weighed me, you know, my weight. That's what I weighed, about 33 kilos. And I was about, you know, to give him that real punch in his face and tear him apart. But I gave him a little punch on my little thing. I thought I almost broke my wrist here. The man said, I know you couldn't beat him. We are going to do it for you. And he gave him a couple of kicks, you know, and pushes, and he pushed him right, you know, in front of the trucks, and he told him to sit down. And he was searched again, you know, underneath the coat and everything, and they took his rifle from upstairs, brought it down, all his things, and in the building, in the corner of the house, they took the rifle, the American soldier, and they broke it, you know. That was, they did with all the rifles. So I said to myself, the Americans, they must be the richest army in the world. They take new rifles, good ones, and they all break them in pieces and make them all big piles. To me, it was, you know, like a mystery. But that was the law, to break all the German rifles and stack them up. And then they went right to that big valley. They arrested all the Germans and the SS, and they led out all the prisoners to go in that little town, Keiling, and around Bad Tells. And everybody started to walk around in Keiling. And my brother noticed me crawling in, but he didn't have a chance. Other guards watched him, even saw him. He couldn't have a chance. So he looked at that gutter, you know. So he figured I must be right there near that big sewer line there. And he walked right in the house, and he saw me. And he said to me, what are you doing in that stables? The Americans are here. I says, I know, brother. Here is all the foods the Americans gave me. Sit down and eat. Oh. And we sat down in the stable boat, and we start eating. And I was already too full, but my brother started eating. And we ate so much in that stable, and we were liberated in that stable by the American God Bless Army.
Thank you so much for telling us these stories. Thank you very much.
I appreciate it. Very happy that I'm sitting near my wife, and I'd like to introduce her, Helene, wonderful wife. I met her in 53 and we got married on December the 19th, and as I told you all the truth now in your camera and all my story, I'm telling the truth again. I love that woman very much. And she was an inspiration and a big help all my life since after the war. We have four children. She gave it to me. She was a very good girl. And we have six grandchildren.
A seventh on the way.
And a seventh on the way. And I hope to live and be alive and tell my seventh grandchild the story, which is not happy stories, but they got to learn the story to know what happened to their grandfather. So I wish to stay alive and in the future to tell my seventh grandchild the story as I told you. Thank you, Helene, for all these years listening to my stories and having mercy on me anytime I lose my temper, because you know that I'm still a Dachau ex-prisoner and went through the Holocaust. And you understand it. And you were nice to me. Thank you very much.
Thank you for good life.
This is my grandfather, my father's father, and his name is Janke Ruchaisky. And he was born in Lithuania.
When was the picture taken?
And that picture was taken, I think, in 1932.
Where?
In Lithuania. Yeah, this picture on the left side, this is me. And my name is Moishe Ruchaisky Rich. Next to me is my mother, Odel Ruchaisky, and her maiden name was Flink. On her lap is sitting my sister, Miriam Ruchaisky. Next to my sister is standing my brother, Avraham Ruchaisky. Next to my brother is standing my sister, Feige Ruchaisky. And in the middle is my father, Chaim Ruchaisky. And that picture was taken when I was 5 years old. That means about 67 years ago.
Where was it taken?
And it was taken in Lithuania, in Slobodka. This is my sister Fega. And that picture was taken in Italy, in Milan, in 1948, after the war. She's now 74 years old, and she lives in Hollywood, Florida. And her married name is Fege Zaltzman. And her husband's name is Mordechai Zaltzman. This is my sister Miriam, and that picture was taken in 1947 in Germany. She lives now in Israel, and her married name is Fuchs, and her husband's name was Jacob. This is my brother, Abraham, and that picture was taken in 1947 in Germany, and he lives now in Florida, on Miami Beach. Okay, this is my lovely wife when we got married. Her name is Eileen, and her maiden name was Farb, and now I made her Eileen Rich, and I'm very happy that we got married December 19, 1953, Miami Beach. This is me, Maurice Rich, before Moshe Ruchaisky. I'm standing by my lathe, by my profession, my trade, and I'm turning wood. And I'm very happy that I had a trade and I could work. And I'm very grateful to my father and grandfather for having a trade, and that saved a little bit staying alive.
Where was this picture taken?
And that picture was taken in my shop in Florida at 98 Northwest 29th Street, Miami, in in 1980. Okay, from left to right, it's my son, Howard Leonard Rich. Next to him is Harley Rich Elliot. Now, the bride is my daughter, Renee Ann Rich. And all the way on the right side is my son, Michael. And that picture was taken 2 years ago at Renee's wedding, Miami. Okay, on the left side is my grandchild, Donna. Next to her is my grandson, Sean. Right to Sean is my grandchild, Dora. And on the lower side, and the left side, is Brian, my grandson. And all the way on the right side, on the lower part, is Gary. And that picture was taken at the wedding of Renee in Miami in 1994. And this is my little grandchild, his sweetheart, Caitlin. And this is the daughter of my daughter, Holly, which her name is Caitlin Elliott. That's what you like, we call her. And she's 2.5 years old, and that picture was taken right in school.
In Miami?
In Miami. Yeah. This is my witness pass. When I was a witness in Dachau against the Dachau commandant Johann Kiers in 1945, and it was a very happy day in my life when that trial was going on. Okay. This document is a Ausweis. It's like a passport. When I was liberated from Dachau, they gave me that, and it tells on that document my number from the concentration camp, 81840, and it was given out in Munich, Germany, after the liberation. And it was done by the American and the temporary German government.